Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Now, feel free to get in touch with us on our socials right below your screen. Tell us where you're watching from or what you want addressed. Also, if there's anything that you've learned from The Business Show and you want to start, we can help you connect up with the people who have done it. That's why we're here, you know. And remember, this show repeats on Saturdays at 8 in the morning, so you have every reason to watch and learn. Let's talk how to make money. And in part two now of our series, we are speaking to Sarah Seraji, who in part one, after she failed to get that job in Bank of Uganda, she decided she was moving on. Plus, COVID-19 was a blessing in disguise, cause at Makere, she was downsized. She was part of the team that was downsized. So she chose to go personal into her business now. And as we speak, she is running a second branch, but also for her, empowering women is bigger than making money. This is how to make money. You are training
women and young girls.
Mm. Is that something you're doing out of love? Or you want to run a business that creates impact in society?
It's both. Out of love, because I've seen, we all, yeah, I may be well off, but I still have relatives who are not. So by helping them, I'm relieved. They won't even tire my own children.
That's right.
Once you empower them with a skill. And also the people I train, they are the same people who come and work. So I'm increasing on production. So it helps me when at a peak season, I just call them up, please, I know this one is good at this, this one is good at that. They may not even come physically here. I may just tell them I need this, we need like 300 skirts. I cut the skirts, send them to them. Then they sew and bring them back and I pay them. So it helps me with production, to increase on my output.
Okay. Let's talk about the vocation still, and what do the intakes look like, and how do girls get to know of these opportunities?
I utilize the social media platforms and also the village. I'm on different village WhatsApp groups, so we make adverts now. Even like you've come. Thank God.
Yeah.
So I when I meet you, I would say 2-3 words. The fourth word will be, by the way, I do this. So from word of mouth, from social media platforms, yes. That's how I get the girls. And we normally target from 13 to 50 years.
Okay. So the interesting question then I want to ask you is separating individual from business. And so this is more like starting from a family. How are you able to be Sarah and be the CEO?
Wow, that is a bit tricky, but it comes in when you are answerable to the client. So you tell these people, by the way, you people, we have to finish these people's orders. You need money, you need to go to school, because most of them are in school by now. So they come and work. I give them a target. I'm like, we only have 3 weeks, you're on holiday, this is your money. You brought a bank slip of 1M. And you don't have even requirements, so better work very fast so that you get to go back to school. So every day I give them a target. You're like, you have to finish these shirts in this time, you have to finish. So we are ever focused. I have a timetable to make them work.
Okay.
Without,
all right, are schools your biggest clients?
Yes.
And do you ever think of making these warmers for the ladies and stuff?
Yes, we do. Now, like, as the peak is going off, we make the warmers. That's when we begin making for individuals. Yes, but when it's a peak season, we are strictly on schools. So when that season is phasing out, first term, we are going in second term, we begin making for the other people.
Yes. So talk to me about what looks like a bad season. When things are not as fast, generally, how does business flow?
It's really slow, especially now, like in second term, if we like May, the rest of the part, from May to November, it's really slow. You have to be very vigilant to see that you have money coming in. That's when the training comes in. That's when we train the women and the young girls. We have vigilant in making adverts. We are vigilant in, you push yourself everywhere you can be seen.
Mm. As a business person, when times are good and you're making money, maybe it's something you want to advise the viewers or the different business people. What should they do when days are good or times are good and they're making money, and then there are going to be seasons when they don't have money? How do you handle that?
When the seasons are good, you have to see how to use the money you've got. How will it sustain you through the other months when there is no money? By not using all of it, by reinvesting it, because right now we are reinvesting in, you're like, okay, let me buy more sewing machines so that I have more women to train. Because if those women come in and they're young girls, you will also be getting more money. Instead of saying, I've arrived. So you reinvest the money in a something that will bring, will keep bringing in revenue.
Apart from the bad season, what are some of the other challenges you face in this business?
The challenge is most of the materials we have on the market, they keep changing. Today you get a good material, the other day it's not what, and yet it's the very manufacturing company that is giving you. Like, for instance, you may go and buy this thread, then you, the next time you buy it, it has like two colors in it. You reach halfway and you won't see it when you're buying. When you're buying, you see this color. But as you're knitting there, you see a different shade. And you're like, okay, now how do I deal with this? So
it's one of those major things that affect your business. Okay, so for anyone watching, they'll then ask, what are some of the things that one should do to be successful in a personalized business where you are the boss and you're answerable to everything?
You have to have passion. In that, even when there is no business going on, you have to think ahead. What do we do in this next season? Try to do other things that don't cost you capital-wise, like the hands-on skills we are doing. There is a time I reached and the season was really low, and I was like, if I'm living here, I pass so many kitchen people who are rearing, who have a business for farming and chicken. They are laying eggs. So I'm like, if I'm going to Ntinda to the first main workshop, let me invest in buying eggs and reselling them. I buy them here cheaply and take them there. Because my argument was, I'm going to drive and go there, use fuel. Whether I want it or not, I have to go to the main branch. So let me go with eggs and they bring in money.
Yeah.
And I mean,
that's more like fueling your car.
Yeah.
What does your business idea look like? So we see you have second branch now. What are the prospects for you?
I want it to be a bigger vocational training institute, which trains women and young girls in employable hands-on skills. And those very people we train, I want them to be working with us. Because sometimes you call people from vocational training institutes and they have not yet mastered the skill. So you find it hard. You're in a busy season. You think you've got tailors, but when they come, they are not doing what you thought they would do. And yet they have the papers, but they've not had real hands-on.
Yeah.
So what we do here, we don't even teach you theory. Practical. You will learn the other types of the machine parts later on, but I just tell you, you turn this, do this, do this, so that we keep even our clients and serve them, I mean deliver the products on time.
All right, so I just thought about this question, and it's to do with women and status. So a woman that works in these organizations, There's the way they are seen. Is that something that ever gets back to you? Because this more or less puts you more like a housewife, yeah, does status ever come back to you, given that you're educated?
Status would be good, but if it's not bringing in money, and I'm just
statusing,
I mean, but you call me and you want me, a tailor, to give you, to bail you out. You don't have fuel, you don't have your car. So status comes if you, it's coming with cash.
Mm.
But if it's just show off, it's just, you're just lying yourself, in fact.
What's your message to the women?
I would encourage women, especially those in the working class,
the so-called corporates.
Yeah, you should learn a hands-on skill. In Luganda, we have a saying that "Amanyo mulimu gw'omutwe tasula anjala." If you have a hands-on skill, you won't sleep hungry.
Mm.
You won't wait for the paycheck. The time I was being employed, I even would forget the dates of the month when we are supposed to be paid, because I have this car income that comes in slowly, slowly.
Mm.
So I would encourage them to learn a skill, and not really. COVID taught us a lot, that you can sit home and you don't even have food, yet you have a degree, you have a PhD. And learn a skill. Learning a skill, we grew up being told that these things are for school dropouts.
Yeah.
And to sit on a machine and you make an outfit like that shirt you're putting on, it doesn't, it's not a piece of cake. You have to be sharp.
All right, so I guess you've learned something from Sarah's story, and she was able to turn passion into money, but it's important for you to also look at what impact you create in society. Are you thinking about just earning and being a successful businessman, or do you want to leave a legacy that says you supported and skilled other people? It is up to you to decide, but it's only fair that we run a business that helps other people as well. Okay, let's talk personal finance tips for this week.
Hello, Augustine Tamale are my names, and I'm still touching on the tough times that we are facing as individuals, as businesses. These times require a lot of wisdom, a lot of precaution. It's very, very key. Now, I talked about unity the other time when it was at family level. Now we have to scale it up and talk about unity beyond even just one home. Unity now for a community. If it is a farming community, is there a cooperative in that community? Is there a cooperative? Is each one going to buy the fertilizers separately? Is each one taking their produce to the market individually? Is each one carrying out the marketing activities individually? This is the time now for the cooperatives to work. If they had collapsed, now resurrect them. This is the moment, because if you are taking produce for all of you, if you utilize a bigger truck, the cost per farmer is going to go down. So together, you're going to fill cargo on that truck so that it heads to the market in one go. If you're doing it as an individual, you are spending a lot of money. Actually, the profit you're going to make from your farm produce is going to be less. So this is the moment. But even on the input side, if you're buying the fertilizers, if you are buying the seedlings alone, you are charged more money for each unit. But if a cooperative society, a primary or secondary one, goes to pick the seedlings, goes to pick the seeds, goes to pick the fertilizers or input equipment, they could be hose or spare parts for a tractor, together you are buying bulk, and the costs will be lower. The bargaining power is even higher, since you are buying a bigger quantity. So So as a cooperative, this is the moment when you are going to lower the costs for each farmer because of your negotiation power. Let me say this, you may not be in farming. Probably for you, you are employees, but is there a circle at your workplace? This is the moment when your resources should be together, such that when it comes to borrowing, you are the ones in charge of your interest rate at which you borrow. Because for a staff savings scheme, or probably even a church one, the interest rate is lower. You are the owners of the money. You are borrowing your own money. So if you are saving together, then your costs of borrowing are going to be lower, up to even an effective rate of 11%. So you are challenging even the rate at which companies borrow. Companies borrow at 12 to 14% from commercial banks. You yourselves, because you've put your savings together, you lend each other at 11%, depending on how you have agreed, maybe even 10. You are almost even touching the interest rate of the microfinance support center when it is giving other institutions of 8%. You are about to touch it. So together you have power. You have the muscle, the financial muscle. Well, organizations have run their staff saving schemes. I'm aware. The new Vision One, the Vision Group One, has moved to now assets worth 10 billion shillings. An entity that started with just as little as 30 million shillings. As little as 30 million shillings about 15 years ago. You can imagine how this has been grown to that extent. So there's a big pool of money which people can access at a lower cost. If, as Ugandans, we can't mobilize savings, our borrowing costs will remain higher because we are borrowing from banks that have owners who want a return on the capital they have injected in. The central bank tells them now increase the amount of capital and they increase. So when they increase it, they need a return on it. It's not idle money, it must make money. So the interest rates will be higher. But as a community, when you put things together, or maybe as a church, as workmates, as people in the same locality, maybe as old students, you can have even your saving scheme or your investment club. Probably even as professionals, I saw the accountants having a saving scheme for their Institute of Certified Public Accountants. So you can have a saving scheme or an investment club, a cooperative, in which you can pull together resources that can help you to borrow at a better cost. And even when you are investing in the financial instruments, when you come with your little money, 2 million, 5 million, you are not handled appropriately. But if you are together and you are buying a treasury bond of 100 million, people respect you. You are able to get the priority in getting that financial instrument. So your own 3 million will be in it and it starts earning you the 17%. Where would you get 17% with 3 million? When you take it to the bank, they want to give you 8% interest on fixed deposit. Who is going to listen to you for a treasury bond of just 3 million? Although the unit is 100,000, but those with bigger money are given priority. So together, you are able to harness this and have the income even jointly and be able to succeed.
So to the Forex market now, and the shilling opened the week relatively low or below the dollar, and we can only hope that this improves. Let's just run you through the comprehensive report now. All right, so there you have it, and I've got to go for now, but You know, I've been following this conversation of KQ in Kenya and how they're making losses. We know for a fact that the aviation industry is not something to play around with. There's so many restrictions. But also generally, business-wise, there's just competition and you must be at your best to make the money. That's no doubt. So with the recent costs of fuel going up and all that, there has been so much pressure on KQ on top of all the losses they had made in the past. What's surprising though is that this time they made the biggest loss ever, $290 million. We can only hope that they can recover within time, yeah? But you know, for you running a business, before you think about anything, I keep saying your business operates more because of the different factors around you. Okay, so if those factors are favorable, then make sure you utilize them and help your business get better. Because you're not an island. I keep saying if fuel is high, most of the things that you transport will go high and the final consumer gets the extra price that is added on. So take advantage of the different platforms that are available and improve your business. My name is Simon. I'll see you soon. For me and the team, you take care of yourselves, keep making money, and bye for now.